Welcome, everyone, to A Conversation with a Mentor. This podcast is presented to you by YLGEN, the Younger Leaders Generation Initiative of the Lausanne Movement. We want to build soul friendships for global missions through whole life mentoring. And today I'm pleased to have as co-host Mark Slaughter from the United States. Hi, Mark.
Hi, Paul.
And also Delphine Fanfun from Cameroon. Delphine was not able to join us live for this episode, but she will be with us at the end of the episode, sharing with us the takeaways and practical insights from our conversation today. Our guests today, we're very pleased to have Soo-Inn Tan and Andrea Summers. Andrea is from the United States. She was at YLG in Jakarta in 2016, and she's been a pastor in the local church and a professor at a Christian university. Currently, she is a campus pastor and dean of spiritual formation at Indiana Wesleyan University. And Andrea has a wonderful husband and 4 school-aged children. And we're very, very happy to have you with us today, Andrea.
Thank you so much. Glad to be here.
Soo-Inn is from Malaysia, and he is based in Singapore. He is the director of Grace Works, a ministry committed to promoting spiritual friendships through publishing and training. He was originally trained as a dentist, and we had a veterinarian. How do you say that, Mark?
A veterinarian.
On another episode, So we said, well, we have a lot of areas of life that are covered if we have any health issues. Soo-Inn is subsequently did also a THM at Regent College and a DMin at Fuller Seminary. He told us that he read The Lord of the Rings 9 times. Can you believe it? Wow. And so we're very happy also to welcome you today, Soo-Inn.
Happy to be here.
Today, Mark, we will talk about a very important topic in our Christian lives and also in our mentoring relationships. It's a topic of spiritual friendship.
That's right, Paul. And it is such a joy to have our 2 friends and colleagues here, Soo-Inn and Andrea, with us to address this topic. So greetings to both of you, and really looking forward to our conversation with both of you. Like we often do, we want to be able to begin by hearing a little bit about each of you and your own stories of your own life and so on. So first to begin, Andrea, I wondered, could you briefly just tell us about yourself and how maybe your childhood and your youth shaped your own view of spiritual friendship?
Yeah. So I grew up in the church. I grew up in a Christian home with wonderful parents. But I think I experienced pretty early on just a desire for more intimacy in my friendships and my relationships. And yet I didn't really know how to get there. I grew up in a wonderful family, but it was a family that had a high value for privacy. And so I think also I had this sense growing up in the church, even in my young adulthood, and then, you know, I found myself headed into vocational ministry and as a pastor, feeling like disappointed by, the church was kind of selling to us this idea of Christian community, that man, if you step into community, you'll be known, you'll be seen, you'll be loved, and you'll belong, and that wasn't always my experience. I was like, oh, if I just join a small group, if I just I'm a part of this programming that the church is offering, then I will truly belong. And so I would step into those things, you know, I would go to the brunch or I would be in the small group or whatever it was, and I would just feel this real sense of disappointment, like this is nice, but this isn't what my soul is longing for. And so and also just feeling like this person that you know, I wanted who I was on the inside to line up with who I was on the outside. And yet I was someone who had trouble being vulnerable. I was someone who had trouble saying I was sorry. I had someone who had trouble sometimes admitting when I was wrong. And, you know, these kinds of things, like I felt like I had to be someone on the outside, that it didn't always line up on that. Anyway, and so this kind of like, it, you know, not in these huge, massive ways, but even just in these teeny tiny small ways, I felt this disconnect. And so it was really several people in my life, one friend in particular that I met when I was in seminary, that just really modeled what spiritual friendship was to me. And they modeled what like that kind of authentic transparency and vulnerability looked like in healthy ways. And so many times we see that show up in unhealthy ways. And so it just, like, when I saw that in living color in my life, it's just kind of like my mind exploded. And I said, I want to live like that too. And so ever since then, so really for probably the last, 15 years of my life, it's been a journey, a pursuit, and it's been one of the greatest. Spiritual friendship for me has been one of the greatest pathways of transformation in my life. Absolutely.
So wonderful to hear. And I hear too in that, Andrea, just how you were longing for so much more. Even when we were in supposedly community, you wanted more. Your soul was hungry for more. And I'm so thankful to hear that friend in seminary that really modeled that and opened up a whole new experience and window for you in your life personally and in your ministry. So Soo-Inn, I'd love to hear the similarly about you. Share with us a little bit, if you could, about your own journey and maybe the role that spiritual friendship has played throughout your own ups and downs in your own life.
Yeah. I came from a small family. It's just me for a long time. My younger sister came about 9 years later. So I remember growing up lonely and without any siblings to be with. Very early, I appreciated friendship in general. And so when I came to know the Lord in a more real way when I was 15, there were always friends in Christ around me. So that wasn't a novel experience. I had friends in Christ all along. I went to dental school. As I said, that was my first life, so to speak. And in the final year of dental school, the Lord called me to vocational Christian work, although I did practice as a dentist for 3 years. My theological education in region was very helpful in giving me theology and language for spiritual friendship, studying with folks like James Houston and others. So that gave me a lot of language, a lot of theology, and fresh conviction that this was fundamental to life, that we need to follow Christ in the company of friends. But I guess it's usually in the dark moments of life that you learn your most important lessons. And I think the death of my first wife from cancer. I was pastoring a big church and she was discovered to have cancer and she passed away a year later. I had two young children, I was pastoring this church and my life just fell apart. I mean, nothing in life prepares you for something like this. But I remarried a couple of years later, that marriage broke down. I ended up going to a period of clinical depression. I call that period my 10 black years, 10 years, one tragedy, one after another. And I look back at that period and I often wonder how I survived because I'm not a strong person. How on earth did I survive those 10 black years? And yet in a way, I know the answer. It was God's grace. And a lot of that grace came to me through my spiritual friends. In fact, in difficult times, you realize who your true friends are. A whole host of friends suddenly lost your phone number or your email address. But there's this small, tiny group who never gave up on you. They may or may not understand all that is happening, but they embraced you for who you are. They cried with you. They walked with you. And if I ever needed reinforcement of the conviction that you need spiritual friends as much as you need food and water, those 10 black years really reinforced that. And now my present ministry, Grace Works, actually is focused on a relational transformation, seeing lives transformed through folks walking together in authentic friendship. So I guess in a nutshell, spiritual friendship has been there all along and really something that I am all sold out to.
Well, 10 dark years there, and for God's grace to come to you through those difficult years, and as some have called the dark night of the soul, you had dark years of the soul, you know, there. And yet to see God's grace there. Paul, I was just thinking about how beautiful it is, though, in each of these two dear friends that God's calling in their lives and ministry really was shaped by in their personal lives first. And it's just so encouraging to hear that, and how some have even said often where God calls us or how God calls us is often where he met us most deeply in our lives. And that's true for Andrea and for Soo-Inn, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly, Mark. We see it's not just an abstract talking topic that we are talking about, but something that affects deeply our lives. And I'm sure a topic that we don't talk enough about in the church and in our ministries. Soo-Inn, you've talked about, I've heard the word authentic friendship there. Maybe a question of our listeners would be, how would you define spiritual friendship?
I think it's important we get this right going forward. I think it was C.S. Lewis who said that every friendship is defined by two things. There's a commonality that links the two friends, and there's a purpose for that friendship. So I would say in spiritual friendship, the commonality is our common link in Christ. It's because we are linked in Christ, we are also linked with each other. And the purpose of that spiritual friendship is we help each other follow Christ. So we follow Christ in the company of friends. So I would see spiritual friendship. We have all sorts of friendship. This is not the only friendship. But once you say spiritual friendship, then Christ is in the midst of it. Christ links us and we want to follow Christ and help each other follow Christ. That's my short definition of spiritual friendship.
Wow, and that's an inspiring definition. Christ at the center of this friendship. Andrea, you've talked about your friendship at college, I was wondering what would be the difference you would make between a friendship and a spiritual friendship? Would you make a difference between both? If yes, what would it be?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, we hear that word friendship, and I think a lot of times we think, oh, yeah, I know all about friendship. I've thought about friendship. I have wonderful friends in my life. So they must be spiritual friends. And I think there is a distinction to be made. Spiritual friendship is, Soo-Inn put it really well. It is a friendship that is characterized by Christ in the center of the friendship. And so because of that, it becomes a means of grace in our lives. It becomes a channel of God's grace into our lives. God uses that to form us in really like supernatural ways. So a spiritual friendship, many times when we think about our friends, the defining characteristic of that friendship is we've had these shared experiences together, or we are in a similar stage of life with children that are similar ages, or it's a friendship of convenience. We work together, so we see each other every day, or we are next door neighbors, or, you know, those sorts of things that do become seedbeds for wonderful friendships. But a spiritual friend, and many spiritual friends can maybe start that way, but a spiritual friendship, the defining characteristic, the bond that connects the two of you is not shared experiences or shared interests. The bond that connects you deeply is Christ's presence in your midst. And that sometimes, I think maybe once or twice over the course of our lives, we can maybe stumble into those kinds of friendships. But I think by and large, To cultivate a friendship where Christ is center requires a tremendous amount of intentionality, especially in the kind of world that we live in now that is so busy and hectic and distracted. I think that cultivating the kind of commitment that kind of a friendship requires takes a tremendous amount of intentionality.
Wow, that's very deep. I quote you when you said it's a means of grace that God uses to transform us. Usually we would think about the reading scripture, praying, having, you know, private devotions, but here spiritual friendship being a means of grace. Soo-Inn, do you agree on that? Would you even say that spiritual friendship could be a spiritual discipline that we have to cultivate?
Of course, I would 100% agree that it is a means of grace. I think of those two friends on the Emmaus Road, and as they walked together, Christ walked with them. And in some ways, we kind of mediate the presence of Christ to each other. And so it's transforming, hence my term about a relational transformation. God's grace comes to us through our friends, and it helps us to grow in Christ-likeness. I think for too long, we think of formation only in terms of reading your Bible, prayer. But I think walking together is key to our growth in Christ-likeness. And so, yes, it is a spiritual discipline to be cultivated. I have kind of a mixed feelings, because when a good friendship happens, there's some sense it is a mystery and a gift. Why do these two people, maybe not having many things in common, suddenly link? And they say, well, what happened here? So I have this sense of gratitude, you know, when things happen. But I also fully agree that because it is so indispensable to our walk, we have to make the effort to make it happen. There is an intentionality where we pray, Lord, lead me to those folks, where maybe we can ask for help from our friends to help us to connect with people. But we have, because it is so critical, we have to make it happen. So when I moved from Kuala Lumpur to Singapore, for that first year, I didn't have the kind of spiritual friendship and I was lost. But I prayed, I worked, I reached out, and after 1 year, I had a spiritual friendship group. And that has made the difference.
Wow, so it's a mystery, but at the same time, you want to be intentional for making it happen. Andrea, maybe some listeners would wonder what are the things I could maybe do to try and find a spiritual friend? Could you help us on this?
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes our spiritual friend is someone who we already have in our life, who... You know, you find that there's a chemistry there maybe already of you laugh at the same jokes and that sort of thing, but you find that your soul is drawn to that person in a spiritual way. And if you find that you have someone like that in your life and you're waiting for, you know, something amazing to blossom, I'd encourage you, you know, if you're listening to this and you're thinking that, I would encourage you to just take that step and initiate something more intentional with that friend to say, can we meet together? Can we pray together? Can we share vulnerably together? Can we have a friendship with no strings attached where my greatest desire out of this friendship is that I would get to witness God helping you become all that he's created you to become. And then you do that in return. I mean, that's the kind of friendship, right? So I think many times the spiritual friends are people who are already in our lives oftentimes. But nevertheless, I also think there are moments when spiritual friends just kind of drop in and out of our lives too. I've had experiences where I've been, you know, on a trip with someone and our lives are such that we can't live life together. We can't see each other every day or maybe even once a year, but we spent 2 weeks together on a trip. And in that moment, in that season, the Lord knitted our hearts together in a really powerful and supernatural way that was incredibly formative for those 2 weeks. And God continues to bear fruit out of that over time. So I think we have to be willing to lean into friendships that are a part of our lives and also friendships that kind of come and go. Probably, you know, I think it's important for us to have spiritual friends that are located right where we live in our current context, that we actually like see each other. There's something about embodied, like just, you know, Christ came in the flesh. And so there is something powerful about having friends that are those embodied friendships. But I would also say that one of my closest spiritual friends is someone who does not live close to me. The Lord has taken our paths in different directions and we live far apart. But we still, we work really hard to be spiritual friends to each other. So I don't know. I think that it's really a process of discernment, Paul. Of discerning. But I think there are a lot of, I did a survey once to pastors who all different ages, different stages, different places in their ministry. And I asked them about spiritual friendship. Is there someone in your life who you would call a spiritual friend? And I defined what spiritual friendship was. And it was amazing to me how many pastors said, no, I don't have anyone like that in my life. You know, not just pastors, but I think people in ministry, people who are in significant spiritual leadership, it becomes the hurdles to spiritual friendship become much more difficult. So it is something that, you know, we need to pray through and discern, because we need those people in our life who are speaking truth and who we can be honest and vulnerable with.
Yeah, that is, I really echo what you're saying. It's so important in our own walks. with Christ. And I know one of the joys of being part of Where All Gen and being in Jakarta in the flesh, as you said, and now being also on Zoom and podcast with others was connecting with people who could become spiritual friends from different cultures, different ages, different walks of life. And it's been so rich. Soo-Inn, talking about people in different stages of life, do you think that a spiritual friendship can look different, whether you're in a different stage of life or gender differences or different cultures? Do you think that friendship could look different?
Well, we bring who we are into the friendship, and we come from different backgrounds. The three things you mentioned: gender, generations, and culture. In my own work with spiritual friendship all these years, and the common belief is that women are more relational, and it is true. Men are more task-oriented. Of course, this is a sweeping statement, but by and large. So when I tell a man, you need to do spiritual friendship, he'll put it on his to-do list, and then he'll go and seek a couple of guys, and they try to start something. And I thought that it'd be easier for the women because they are more relational. But precisely because they are more relational, they are a bit more hesitant to start a friendship in case it doesn't work out. And then the emotional pain is harder. So to my surprise, I thought the ladies would rush into spiritual friendship, but I found out that actually, and they told me, said, "Soo-Inn, don't treat us as guys. No, we are different." And it's precisely because we put a high premium on friendship that we want to think a bit more before we enter into something, just in case it doesn't work out, and the pain and the discomfort that comes from that. But that's what I've discovered. I'm not sure how true this is in other parts of the world. As for generations, I think boomer, and the guys who are older, I think our generation is much more task-oriented, more stoic, more let's get things done. And relationships doesn't really happen that naturally. We're very happy getting things done, but ask us to do relationships, it doesn't come that easily to us boomers and the silent generation. Whereas our younger friends, the millennials and younger, or even in between, they are much more relational. And that makes their expectations higher, for one thing. And so when those expectations may not be met, there could be a disappointment. And there's this paradox that they are more used to relating online than face-to-face. And so when a survey was done about who are the lonely people, one group were the seniors. And I get that. Many of our friends begin to suffer from ill health or go back to heaven or whatever. But the second group that talked about loneliness were young people. I said, "My goodness, you got 1,000 friends on Facebook. What is this about?" But I realized that connecting online, it's not the same. I think it is not fair to say it's not important, but it's not the same as connecting face-to-face. And they may need to learn how to do that because they seem to have been more committed to meeting online. As for culture, well, there's so many cultures in the world. We celebrate all of them. But there's some elements of Asian culture, those countries more influenced by Confucianism, like Japan, China, which are much more private cultures. And friendship demands some degree of self-disclosure. But private cultures, they find it very, very hard to make that breakthrough. And I'm not to say that's impossible, but it's very hard. Whereas other cultures are very warm and relational. They open up to you straight away. So no matter who are you listening to this podcast, we're here to affirm all cultures. I think Christ is above culture. But we can see how different cultures will have different struggles entering into spiritual friendship. My dream really is that our spiritual friendship should come from people who are different from us as well. I think men and women have so much to learn from each other. God has made us male and female for a purpose. And men have so much to learn from women and vice versa. And we need to say this. And different generations. I have many mentoring groups who are 20 years my junior, and I learned so much from them. These are folks who are late millennials, Gen Xers. I learned so much from them, and it's vice versa. And the different cultures, some of my best friends from different countries, from Hong Kong, from Switzerland, from Grenada, and yet this were the groups in seminary where I learned so much from them. So I think 1 Corinthians 12, we are meant to be a unity with diversity. And the diversity is for us to be interdependent. And my prayer, and I know this needs work, but I'm hoping that yes, there are generational differences, there are gender differences, but But I pray that our model of friendship down the road would be one that would help different types of people work together as friends.
I really love what you said, that you bring who you are in the friendship, and also having this diversity is meeting people who are different from us. And I've also heard clarifying expectations that can maybe sometimes be help people who maybe in different stages of life to understand what they expect a little bit in the friendship. Andrea, some listeners might ask, how do you exactly live these friendships? Do they just go free flowing? Are you intentional about when you meet with a spiritual friend? What do you exactly do when you're meeting with them? How does that work out for you?
Well, I would say, I mean, someone like Soo-Inn, who has, you know, he just exudes spiritual friendship. If you've been around him at all or talked to him at all, like he probably enters every relationship offering spiritual friendship, because he has lived that out in his life, and he does it so naturally. It's second nature to him. So I think, you know, that's the ideal. We get to that point where we offer spiritual friendship in every moment. Every relationship is an opportunity to be, you know, the point in my, the goal of spiritual friendship is to help the other pay attention to God in their life. It's a spiritual discernment process. And then they do that back for you. And so, you know, we have the capacity to do that in every interaction we have with other people. That's the ideal. However, I work with college students. I work on a college campus, and this is what I think about every day is spiritual formation on behalf of a college campus. And I struggle with cultivating spiritual friendships for sure in my own life. Certainly college students, like if we just say, just be a spiritual friend, everyone you talk to, you know, just like Soo-Inn, then you might like, they need some handholds. They need to see it. They need a guide to help them actually experiment with this in their own life to the point where they can go, oh, now I get it. I see what it is. It's a very, it's a difficult concept to grasp. So when I'm working with college students, this is what I tell them. I mean, I'm not going to go into great detail here, but I tell them that actually structure is better when you're first learning about spiritual friendship, and you're not sure, you have a friendship with someone where you feel like your soul is drawn to theirs and their soul is drawn. It's Christ or the spirit between you is pulling you together. You probably do need some structure actually to take that to the next level. And so I find that giving a tremendous amount of structure to friendship like that actually frees us up to really listen to the Holy Spirit. You think it'd be the opposite. You think, oh, you know, just listen to the Holy Spirit and just really free flowing. No, actually, if we have a lot of structure, then inside that structure, we open ourselves up to God's presence and God's God speaking to us. So it's a structure around a lot of prayer, centering prayer, listening to scripture, sharing vulnerably, and everything that we're listening and seeing in the midst of that conversation, we are passing it through the Holy Spirit. So I'm not saying anything to my spiritual friend, and they're not saying anything back to me unless we have discerned that that's something that needs to be shared in the context of that friendship. And so there's this discerning process, and then we're praying for one another. So when my friend shares vulnerably about something going on in their life or a decision they have to make or whatever, like we want to pray for them, not just like a cursory prayer, but we want to really intercede on their behalf. So it's a lot of, there's a lot of vulnerable, there has to be a commitment to vulnerable sharing, and there has to be a lot of prayer. I'll just say this one thing as well that I think is important to note is I always encourage people, if they're entering into a more defined relationship of spiritual friendship, I really encourage them to share their whole story, start to finish. That's the first thing they do in that spiritual friendship. Because usually friendship works this way, where we kind of very slowly just share a little bit and a little bit and a little bit and a little bit. And that's okay. That's actually a really healthy and natural way to open up in friendship. But when it comes to spiritual friendship, if the Holy Spirit is knitting your hearts together and calling you into something deeper, I think it's actually really important to jump into the deep end of the pool. And it's important to say, okay, we're going to start with this baseline of vulnerability. We're going to trust God in this. And I'm just going to share my whole, I'm going to take an hour and I'm going to share my whole story with these two other people or whatever. And then they're going to listen deeply to me share my story. I'm going to feel known and seen maybe for the first time in my life. And they're going to pray for me. And that sets this tone for the spiritual friendship moving forward that says, okay, next time when what I'm sharing vulnerably about is something to do with my parents, for example, well, they have a context for my life and my story. And they know, is it good that my parents are coming to visit this weekend? Is it bad? Is it, you know, what does that mean? Because we have a context for our relationship. So those are a few quick things maybe.
Wow. I'm sure also that those who are listening who were at Jakarta in 2016 remember in the small groups the time we had with life mapping and sharing our stories with complete strangers. We shared Christ together, so we were not really strangers, but we didn't know each other, and it really created such a bond in just a few days. And so thanks for sharing that and all these insights that show us. I was thinking of the word do you say that in English? Liturgy. A liturgical friendship, in the sense that, you know, it creates a pathway also to meet with God through our friends. And that's very, very, very inspiring. Soo-Inn, I've heard and I've read actually a book that you've wrote on spiritual friendship. I don't know if you remember, but you gave it to me in Jakarta at the time when we met at the end of one conference there. I was also deeply impacted by, you know, the simplicity and depth of what you wrote. Could you very briefly just tell us about a concept that you've written in it that is called 1-2-3? What does it mean?
Well, actually, it's 3-2-1. Well,
it's 3-2-1. Yeah, sorry. I thought I'd make sure.
Well, whenever I talk about spiritual friendship and I try to give a biblical basis for it, and no one will say that this is something bad. So, oh, this is important, but I'm just too busy. I get this all the time, especially in large urban centers like Singapore or Kuala Lumpur, maybe in other parts of the world where the pace of life is not so fast, I may not get that reaction, but the context in which I function, hey, this is cool, I've got no time. So I was just asking the Lord for some doable model for spiritual friendship. And so 3-2-1 is actually basically three friends meeting 2 hours once a month over a meal. It's just a cute title. I mean, can it be 4-2-1, of course? I'm just a title that people can remember. But to my surprise, it's been out for about 8 years now, and folks have found this very useful. And so I hate to say this, but if you want to start a spiritual friendship group, get a copy of this. Everybody read through this, because it provides basic biblical material as to the why of spiritual friendship and many practical ideas as to the how. You know, we share a meal, we share our life stories. Whatever. So there are also things that can guide the slightly more structured part of spiritual friendship. So 3-2-1 is a book I wrote about 8 years ago to provide folks with some doable model of spiritual friendship in a busy world. That's 3-2-1.
Wow. 3 people, 2 hours, once a month around.
Over a meal. Yeah. And it's available on Amazon Book Depository if you want to look for it. Yeah.
That's very inspiring and practical. Well, Mark, already in this episode and conversation, we've had so many rich insights, and it's so encouraging to hear all these things about spiritual friendship. And now I'm longing to see also how this impacts and the topic of mentoring, but that is also at the center of the podcast.
Well, that's right, Paul. And as you know, our podcast is entitled A Conversation with a Mentor. And so our unique focus here has been to address topics that will help all of us grow and improve as we are mentoring others. And so, but before we jump into that, I just wanted to say, Paul, I'm just moved by, and I hope our listeners are as well, by how grateful we are to have both of these guests here. Soo-Inn has written a book on spiritual friendships, and Andrea has, that was the focus of her doctoral studies. So we have two people with extensive personal life experience, but also where they've written about this. So very grateful. But Andrea, I would really like to be able to ask you, as we move into some talk about how spiritual friendship intersects with mentoring, what do you see in terms of the link between spiritual friendship and mentoring?
Yeah, well, I mean, of course, we know there are different kinds of mentoring, right? There are, you know, there's vocational mentoring, there's mentoring where it's, you know, the focus is really like kind of imparting some sort of life skill or some ministry skill, that sort of thing. But I will say that as I serve with many of you on the mentoring team for WildGen, and that's the heart behind WildGen and the type of mentoring. I mean, we talk a lot about whole life mentoring. We talk a lot about friendship as one of the core values for a WildGen. And it is because we're interested in heart transformation. We're interested in deep life transformation. And so I really think that spiritual friendship is the place where that happens. And so that's kind of the type of mentoring that we probably pray towards and want to lean into as Lausanne and WildGen. But so yeah, that deeply transformative mentoring that is mentoring of the whole life, I think has to incorporate spiritual friendship in some capacity. And so those are mentoring relationships where it's give and take. It's not just, well, I'm the expert over here and I'm just gonna pour, you know, give all of my advice on here down to you. I mean, obviously there is a dynamic there of someone who's oftentimes more seasoned in life with more experience, but it still becomes this friendship where we both actually have things to offer each other. We both have things to learn from one another. And again, that idea, we keep coming back to it, but I can't get away from it. It's an idea that Christ is the center, that if a mentor and the mentee are meeting, it's not just two people meeting, that there is a third there. That Christ is there with you and that Christ becomes that defining piece of the mentoring relationship. I think also that mentoring relationship, it's characterized by vulnerability, that becomes an expectation that we set up from the very beginning. If we're going to start, and actually I do that, anyone that I mentor, I say at the very beginning, I'm going to be willing to share vulnerably as it's appropriate, you know, in my role as a campus pastor. And the expectation is that you be willing to the extent that you are able to, in your, you know, this stage of life for you right now, I want you to be willing to take risks. Whatever taking risks looks like for you right now, I want you to take risks when it comes to vulnerability and sharing and that sort, because it's in that place of vulnerability and humility is really what that requires, that the Holy Spirit meets us and changes us and opens up new things for us. So I absolutely think that that's an important part to incorporate into a mentoring relationship.
Oh, we can hear so much of the values of WildGen coming through so clearly as I hear you speak about vulnerability, mutuality, friendship, and where it's really a whole life mentoring. So it's very, very appropriate, very encouraging to have this topic. Another part of the spiritual friendship involves listening well as people are just self-disclosing and sharing their souls and their experiences vulnerably. Soo-Inn, I know we've talked some about your listening together, and you've talked about using your three ears when you listen. Tell us a little bit more about what that is, using your three ears in listening.
That may sound a bit grotesque, but okay, here we go.
I only have two.
Actually, the heart of mentoring and spiritual friendship is listening. When we give someone the gift of listening, we invite them to share their life. And when they share their life, they begin to see the fingerprints of God in their life. So for them to process their life, they need to articulate their story. And for that to happen, someone needs to give them the gift of listening. So, and really empathetic listening, which comes easier to some of us than others. I tend to talk too much. But empathetic listening means we listen not just to ideas, but to emotions, to the whole person. And really, there's no magic to this. We learn to do this by doing it. But I mentioned about three ears in the sense that there are at least three things we must pay attention to when we listen to someone. And listening is hard work, by the way, as all of you will know. To be really present and listening empathetically is hard work. But I listen for three things. One is I listen, of course, to the mentee or the mentoree or whatever, and my friend. And I need to be focused and listening to what is said, to what is not said, to body language. I need to hear what is coming across to me from my friend or from my mentoree. But the second one, and as Andrea has mentioned a number of times, is we need to listen to God. The Holy Spirit is here. The Spirit of Christ is among us. And sometimes He will give insights to a situation that comes from Him. This is not because we are a good listener, but God may sometimes whisper something that may give an insight or a breakthrough to a situation that you're trying to get a grasp of. So these two things, I've been reminded that we have eyelids so we can close our eyes, but we have no ear lids. So listening is crucial for life. You can't close your ears. So this is 2 years. Now this third year thing came a bit later in my ministry and life. And it's because I realized that none of us come to any relationship, mentoring or spiritual friendship, tabula rasa, blank. We all come with our own bias. And they affect us more than we realize. We see people, we hear things through the filter of our own bias. And I need to be aware of that as well. So you're a reform guy talking to a charismatic, you're a Democrat talking to a Republican, you are black talking to a white or whatever. I think we want to be as mature and to be as aware of our bias as much as possible. We should be on a long-term journey of being mature and moving away from erroneous bias, but nevertheless, they're still there. So at the very least, I want to be aware of them. I see you, I see my bias. I'm not going to let that intrude into my listening to a friend. I'm aware of my bias. I try my best to push it aside. I'm going to give this person the gift of listening as clean a slate as I'm hoping that he will listen to me, even if we are from different backgrounds. So listening to the mentoree, the friend, listening to God, and being aware of your own bias. So these are the three things that I think that should be in play when we do the hard work of listening.
That's a fresh perspective, my friend. And the bias dimension is one we often neglect or don't mention. And so listening to the other, to God, to the Holy Spirit, and then to my own bias. You know, Andrea, as I think about those kinds of friendships, I'm sure many people would be listening to the podcast right now saying, how can I start? I want to develop these kinds of spiritual friendships and mentoring and see that integrated. But what would you say to people on how they could actually start in developing these kinds of spiritual friendships and mentoring relationships?
Probably three things. One, spend some time praying and discerning who is it in my life right now that I just feel like my soul is drawn to. Not who is the person that, you know, a friendship with them will really like help me along in life or something like, you know, like with so many times we get our own personal biases, or, you know, kind of what Soo-Inn was talking about. We get our own kind of personal things that we want out of life. And we think maybe that friend will help us get it. That's not, or, you know, like just pay attention to the Holy Spirit in your life and inside you. Who is it that your soul is drawn to and calls out to? And then be willing to take, you know, or maybe make a list of two or three people, maybe not just one person, and be willing to invite them into something that is a little more intentional. Say, hey, would you be willing, you know, you could incorporate something like Soo-Inn suggested, that 3-2-1, like, would you be willing to do something a little more intentional with me? I think, you have to be willing to share your whole story with that person. If there's stuff that you're wanting to hold back about your life, then you're maybe not quite ready for a spiritual friendship yet. So be willing to share your whole story with that person and then get together with them. And I mean, just really through trial and error, I created a guide that's like 5 steps. I'm not going to get into the 5 steps today. I'm just going to simplify it. That if you're getting together on a consistent basis and that consistency piece is key, you're praying to discern, Lord, what is it that you want me to share with my spiritual friend today? There's a million different things going on in our life. There's lots of noise and chaos happening in our life. Usually though, there's really just one thing that the Holy Spirit wants you to unpack with the spiritual friend. So we're both spending time, or there's three or four of us. I think my personal opinion is 2 is okay, 3 is better, 4 is almost too big. But if you have a small group like that, you're all praying and discerning, okay, what is it that I need to share with that person? And then you're actually sharing it. Then you're listening deeply as the other people share. You're not offering advice. You're not interrupting and telling your own story and saying, this reminds me of, but you're just listening deeply, listening, using those three ears that Soo-Inn talked about. And then you're praying for that person. And so it's a lot of prayer included in that. That's, I mean, if I could simplify it to someone who's going, where do I start? That's where I would start.
Very clear and practical, wise words there for us. Thank you so much, Andrea. And one of the things we talk about in Wild Gen as well is how we love seeing these kinds of relationships happen across different generations of spiritual friendship in Wild Gen. Soo-Inn, I wonder if you, do you have any words of encouragement for our listeners and for all of us to be able to say, how can we encourage that kind of intergenerational spiritual friendship to be happening in Wild Gen?
First of all, I hope I can access to those five things that Andrea talked about. I hope somewhere I can get those five things. And I also want to say that this kind of closeness may be intimidating for some at first. So maybe we can start at the level of a social group where we share meals. And then we begin to connect. Then maybe a small group, our cell groups. And then maybe out of that may bring that kind of heart-to-heart connection that we are drawn to. So I'm just saying that different people may be ready for different levels of spiritual friendship. Some not, the kind of one, the kind of spiritual friendship we are talking about is that kind of really bonding of hearts. That's what we want to aim at. But I've come to terms that people are ready for different levels of connecting. So we say out there are other levels of friendship, sharing meals, cell groups, then maybe, and what we hope for in the end will be a more heart-to-heart bonding that we are talking about. I think now is the time, really, for a focus on spiritual friendship in mentoring. I find that we now live with the era of the internet, in the knowledge generation. Young people don't need old people for information anymore. In fact, I think this is the first time in history where the young may know more than the old because they have access to the internet. In the days before that, the old guys got know more than the young, but those days are gone forever. My kids know more than me because of the internet. But what the young need is not information from old folks, but they need trusted friends and guides to walk with them as they process life. Because we have lived experience, they have learned experience through what they have learned through the internet, through their formal education, but we have lived experience. And ideally, this is what we in Wild Gen must be investing in, this kind of friendship mentoring between the older and younger generations. And in return, we, the oldies, learn from them. I think the best mentoring is always mutual. I learned so much from my younger friends, but now is the time, because now's the time. It's not just to push info. We see we still push a lot of information. This lecture, this article. And in my mind, the young folks don't really need you for these things. They can hunt us down by themselves. But they are hungry and desperate for an older friend to walk with them. This is the cry I get. There are many more young people looking for mentors than older people willing to be mentors. This is my experience. I don't know what is this in your situation. Because many of us older folks are scared. They've never been mentored themselves. They don't know what this animal is. And some of them, they spoil it by micromanaging the young and kind of take over their lives and tell them what to do, and the young just run away. So we really need to do this, and we need to do this properly. I think now is the time when the different generations have so much to give each other. As we walk together. So yeah, my dear brothers and my new friends, the gift of you guys, let's do this. Let's push the Wild Gen mentoring mandate, because they are crying out for friends to walk with them and not just info. And that's what mentoring is, walking with people to help them hear the voice of God for their own transformation. So let's do it.
Well, that is so insightful. And Soo-Inn, I thought you're right that a lot of senior leaders, you know, that I've worked with, you know, it's quite intimidating sometimes to think. In fact, one said to me, who am I to be a mentor? You know, and the person had incredible experience. But in reality, the leader, other people were looking for a simple, vulnerable, mutual kind of friendship, like we've talked about, a spiritual friendship that was a friend on the journey, someone that would listen deeply to them. And it is so life-giving, both in all directions, young, old, and middle-aged. So it is indeed life-giving. Well, we've shared a lot of great things on this podcast. I wonder, some of our listeners might be wanting to pursue this a little bit more deeply. And so I want to ask each of you what would be maybe a couple of resources that you might recommend if someone wants to explore this topic of spiritual friendships and mentoring more deeply. So first, Andrea, what would be a couple of resources you might recommend for our listeners that want to dig deeper?
Yeah, I think a good little primer, it's a quick read, it's an easy read, is Mindy Kaliguire's Spiritual Friendship is the title of the book. It's a small one, but it's a good one. And she gives a good definition and goes to scripture. What is scripture? What are some examples of spiritual friendship in scripture, which I think is really helpful. And then one that's a little thicker, but I think it's still really applicable is, let's see, let me find it real quick. Spiritual Friendship. Sacred Companions, rather. The Gift of Spiritual Friendship and Direction by David Benner.
David Benner.
And that's a really good one too. I think, you know, if there are folks who, again, I don't want to be presumptuous, but again, the guide that I have, it's literally a one sheet guide that if someone says, you know, I need something that's structured for me. Like some of you, you already do this in your life, or you can kind of step into it and you kind of know what to do and how to spend that time. If you're someone who goes, I think I would actually benefit from having a structure that says, do this for 5 minutes, do this for 10 minutes, do this for 15 minutes. That's still, it's very simple. Just email me and I would be happy to share that guide with anyone who's interested. It is something that has born real fruit in my life, and I've used it on 2 college campuses now, and it seems to be something that young people connect with. So
that sounds wonderful. Would you be able to give us your email address in case someone wants to email you that for that resource?
Yeah, AndreaLSummers@gmail.com. Would it be helpful if I put it in the chat? I don't know.
And we will post that on the social media when we post the podcast, but that would be a wonderful resource, a simple, clear, one-page framework that often, like you said, having a beginning framework gives the structure that gives people a lot of encouragement to move forward. So let's make sure we'll make that available, and be sure to email Andrea for that. Soo-Inn, what would be a couple of resources you might recommend as well?
Well, I'm taking my baby steps into micro teaching, and by the end of the year, that could be a whole course on spiritual mentoring, all in 10-minute segments. So when that happens, I'm not sure how good it's going to be. I'll let you guys know. But this is the 3-to-1 book on a basic primer on spiritual friendship. 3-to-1. The two books I've used, as I've mentioned, in terms of spiritual mentoring would be Anderson and Rees, although dear Rees has passed away, but Anderson and Rees, because they are biblical, they have historical models, as well as practical exercises. So I think there's no perfect book, but this is my fallback as a book on spiritual mentoring. The book I personally like about spiritual friendship is actually Becoming Friends by Paul Waddell. He says here he is professor of religious studies at St. Norbert College, Wisconsin. So there it is. And what I like about this book, because he also talks about friendship as a witness to the world. And I think I need to say this too, that friendship is not just about us. The world is so lonely and fragmented that when they see a group of people, especially if they are different, and yet they genuinely love one another, say, hey, what's happening here? The world is so divided now. So I think there's also a missional dimension to spiritual friendship, that when folks walk together who you may not expect to walk together, there is a gospel statement there. So I like this, but that was one of the chapters talks about spiritual friendship for the world. And I think that's one dimension we didn't talk about. I forgot all about it until I saw the book again. The friendship is not just about us. It is also a testament of the gospel to the world. So there are tons of books out there, but these are just 3 that are my own favorites.
Well, we've provided some good options there for people to explore further, each of them with their own little slants that are unique. And so we would be glad to recommend those to people and in following up to this podcast. Well, this has been a wonderful, wonderful time to be able to address this topic of spiritual friendship and mentoring. And I want to just simply thank you, Andrea and Soo-Inn, for joining us. And it has been a sheer delight And I'm sure our listeners have enjoyed this very much. So thank you to both of you for joining us today.
Yeah. Thank God for the gift of your friendships. Sorry.
No, it's good to be here. Thanks so much for having me. And gotten to work a little bit with Soo-Inn with Wild Gen stuff, but it's been such a joy to get to know you better, Soo-Inn. Yeah.
Looking forward to working together more. You're a
special friend to me, so thank you.
That's right. And we all have the joy of serving together on the Wild Gen mentoring team together. And it's such a joy to partner with all of us here on this team. So, well, God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us, Soo-Inn and Andrea.
Oh, joy. Bye-bye.
Well, we're so happy, Delphine, to have you on this podcast and to share with us some insights, some golden nuggets that we can take away from this great conversation we had today with Andrea and Soo-Inn.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Paul. Should I just say that I have so much respect for Mark now that I have to do these golden nuggets? It is no easy assignment. It has been such a rich conversation with Soo-Inn and Angela, so much to learn and so much to retain from all that they said. And to help us do that, I am going to be sharing what I call the three P's of spiritual friendship. As I listened to them, I was able to come up with these three things, which I hope actually capture what this is really about. The first P would be the purpose. What is the purpose of spiritual friendship? And I like the way they put it, the means of grace for fellow travelers on the same road towards the mission of God in this life. And I think that that really, really captures it. As our audience, as you listen to this and as you consider spiritual friendships, there couldn't be anything deeper than this purpose right here. The second P, actually, I have four things to share under that, and it's what I'm calling the principles of effective spiritual friendships. Number one, spiritual friendships require intentionality. I can't count how many times they said the word intentionality. And so we each being willing to take the first step to either lean into existing relationships or seek out new opportunities to be able to generate or to nurture these friendships. The second principle would be the need for cultivation, ongoing cultivation. I think both of them underlined the reality that there is a lot of work that goes into keeping these friendships nurturing and productive and meeting that big purpose that we have seen. The third principle would be the need to seek not only people that are like us, but people that are different from us as well, so that we can learn and broaden the scope of what we can take away from each and every single spiritual friendship that we cultivate. Finally, the last P is the need to dive in deep, you know, no need to play it shallow, because this is a relationship that is centered on Christ, and prayer is such an integral part, and context, therefore, is everything to ensure that the right kind of prayer is happening and that these friends are connecting in the deep ways that are required by such a spiritual friendship. There goes the second P. The third P then is what I call the process. What is the process of nurturing spiritual friendships? First, spending time to pray, to ask the Lord and to discern, who is my soul being drawn to? Who are the people that can be spiritual friends for me on this journey? I think that's the first thing that happens if you're seeking, if you're in a place listening to this going, yeah, I do need spiritual friends in my life, spending time to pray and to discern who your soul is being drawn to would be the very first thing to do. And after having discerned who that person is, be willing to invite that person into an intentional relationship. And that's where the 3-2-1 comes in, being clear in your expectations and making sure that the focus and the goal of the relationship is communicated right from the start. And after having done that, when this friendship starts, do not hold anything back. Share your entire story with this person that you are seeking to cultivate this spiritual friendship with. And then after sharing deeply with this person, listen empathetically. Okay, I really liked what Soo-Inn said about listening. The three, listening to the mentee or the person that you are in this friendship with, listening to the Lord as you listen to this person, so that you're not giving your own personal advice or sharing your own thoughts with this person, but you are connecting with the Lord's purpose for that person, which is the purpose of the friendship in the first place. And then listening to yourself. What are your biases? What are your assumptions as you go into this friendship and as you listen to this person? And then, of course, pray. Pray. This is a spiritual friendship. It's all about centering our hearts on the Lord. It's all about seeking the best of the Lord for the person that you're in this friendship with. And so the process is not complete until intentional prayer has gone into that. I know there is a whole lot more that was shared in this podcast, but I do hope that these three P's at least can help you retain the essential element as far as the role of spiritual friendship in whole life mentoring.
Wow, thank you so much, Delphine, for managing to boil down this great conversation into these three P's that we can take away with us: the purpose of spiritual friendship, the principles, and the process. These are things that hopefully we can all continue to chew on and to discuss in our different spiritual friendship relationships and mentoring relationships. This is the end of our episode today. Thank you so much again, all of you, for joining us and for listening to this podcast. We can continue to discuss in the Facebook page and find the replay of the episode either on the WildGen Facebook group or on the Connector app. And we'll see each other for another episode of A Conversation with a Mentor. And until then, let's continue to build soul friendships for global missions through whole life mentoring.